What is a process? In this video, we are going to see about what is a process. An instance of a program is called a process. In simple terms, any command that you give to your Linux machine starts a new process. It's possible to have multiple processes for the same program. Types of processes. Foreground processes. They run on the screen and need input from the user. For example, office programs. Background processes. They run in the background and usually do not need user input. For example, antivirus. Running a foreground process. To start a foreground process, you can either run it from the dashboard or you can run it from the terminal. When using the terminal, you will have to wait until the foreground process runs. Running a background process. If you start a foreground program or process from the terminal, then you cannot work on the terminal till the program is up and running. Certain data-intensive tasks take lots of processing power and may even take hours to complete. You do not want your terminal to be held up for such a long time. Listing process. In this video, we are going to see about listing process. Process. A process is a set of instructions loaded into memory. Numeric process ID, that is PID, used for identification. UID, GID, and SC Linux context determines file system access. The Linux kernel tracks every aspect of a process by its PID under /proc/PID. Listing process. The ps command is used to view the process information. By default, shows processes from the current terminal. Options. Shows processes from all the terminal. X shows all the processes owned by you or shows all the processes when used together with the A option, such as PS AX, including processes that are not controlled by a terminal, such as daemon processes. This shows up as in the TTY column of the output. U shows process owner information. F shows process parentage. O shows custom information such as PID, TTY, STAT, NICE, percentage CPU, percentage MEM, time, COMM, command, EUSER, RUSER. Finding process. In this video, we are going to see about finding process. Process status. Every process has a state property, which describes whether the process is actively using the CPU, that is running in memory, but not doing anything, that is sleeping, waiting for a response to become available, that is uninterruptible sleep, or terminated but not flushed from the process list, that is zombie. running and sleeping are normal, but the presence of uninterruptible sleep or zombie processes may indicate problems lurking on your system. Uninterruptible sleep. Process is sleeping and cannot be woken up until an event occurs. It cannot be woken up by a signal. Typically, the result of input or output operations, such as a failed network connection, that is for NFS hard mounts. Zombie. Just before a process dies, it sends a signal to its parent and waits for an acknowledgement before terminating. Even if the parent process does not immediately acknowledge this signal, all resources except for the process identity number, that is PID, are released. Zombie processes are cleared from the system during the next system reboot and do not adversely affect system performance. Finding process. Signals. In this video, we are going to see about signals. Signals are simple messages that can be communicated to processes with commands like kill. Sent directly to processes, no user interface required. Programs associate actions with each signal. Signals are specified by name or number when sent when 7 signals shows complete list. Signal 1 HUP, that is SIGHUP, that is reread configuration files. Signal 9 KILL, that is SIGKILL, terminate immediately. Signal 15 TERM, that is SIGTERM, terminate cleanly. Signal 18 CONT, that is SIGCONT, continue if stopped. Signal 19 STOP, that is SIGSTOP, stop process. Sending signals. In this video, we are going to see about sending signals. A program can signal a different program using the kill system call with prototype. This will send the signal with number SIG to the process with process ID PID. Signal numbers are small positive integers. For the definitions on your machine, try /user/include/bits/sign-num.h. Note that these definitions depend on OS and architecture. A user can send a signal from the command line using the kill command. Common uses are kill9n to kill the process with PIDN or kill1n to force process N, maybe init or inetd, to reread its configuration file. Certain user actions will make the kernel send a signal to a process or group of processes, typing the interrupt character, that is probably Ctrl+C, causes SIGINT to be sent. Typing the quit character, that is probably Ctrl/sends SIGQUIT. Hanging up the phone, that is modem sends SIGHUP, typing the stop character, probably Ctrl Z, sends SIGSTOP. Certain program actions will make the kernel send a signal to that process. For an illegal instruction, one gets SIGILL for accessing non-existing memory, one gets SIGSCGV for writing to a pipe while nobody is listening anymore. On the other side, one gets SIGPIPE for reading from the terminal, while in the background, one gets SIGTTIN, etc. More interesting communication from the kernel is also possible. One can ask the kernel to be notified when something happens on a given file descriptor. See fcntl2, and then there is ptrace2. A whole group of signals is reserved for real-time use. Receiving signals. In this video, we are going to see about receiving signals. When a process receives a signal, a default action happens unless the process has arranged to handle the signal. For example, by default, SIGHUP, SIGINT, SIGKILL will kill the process. SIGQUIT will kill the process and force a code dump. SIGSTOP, SIGTTIN will stop the process. SIGCONT will continue a stopped process. SIGCHLD will be ignored. Traditionally, one sets up a handler for the signal using the signal system call with prototype. This sets up the routine handler as handler for signals with number SIG. The return value is the address of the old handler. The special values SIGDFL and SIGIGN denote the default action and ignoring respectively. When a signal arrives, the process is interrupted. The current registers are saved and the signal handler is invoked. When the signal handler returns, the interrupted activity is continued. It is difficult to do interesting things in a signal handler because the process can be interrupted in an arbitrary place, data structures can be in arbitrary state, etc. The three most common things to do in a signal handler are: set a flag variable and return immediately. Messy, throw away all the program was doing and restart at some convenient point, perhaps the main command loop or so. Clean up and exit. Setting up a handler for a signal is called catching the signal. The signals SIGKILL and SIGSTOP cannot be caught or blocked or ignored. Scheduling priority. In this video, we are going to see about scheduling priority. Every running process in Unix has a priority assigned to it. You can change the process priority using NICE and RENICE utility. NICE command will launch a process with an user-defined scheduling priority. RENICE command will modify the scheduling priority of a running process. Linux kernel schedules the process and allocates CPU time accordingly for each of them. But when one of your processes requires higher priority to get more CPU time, you can use nice and renice command. The process scheduling priority range is from minus 20 to 19. We call this as nice value. A nice value of minus 20 represents highest priority, and a nice value of 19 represent least priority for a process. By default, when a process starts, it gets the default priority of 0. Display nice value of a process. The current priority of a process can be displayed using ps command. The ni column in the ps command output indicates the current nice value, that is priority of a process. A test program called test.pl, which will be used to demonstrate nice and renice command. This test program will do certain task and will be running for a while. If you execute ps command as shown below, you can notice that this test.pl program has the default nice value of 0. Let us look at the ni column in the following output. Launch a program with less priority. Instead of launching the program with a default priority, you can use nice command to launch the process with a specific priority. In this example, test.pl is launched with a nice value of 10. Remember that minus 10 in the above command set the priority of a process to 10. The in-nice command stands for the hyphen, which we use to pass options to the command. So, to pass nice value of 5, you will see minus 5. To pass nice value of 6, you will see minus 6. As you see below, this program is now launched with a nice value of 10, which means this will run at a lower priority when compared to other programs that are launched by default. Launch a program with high priority. You can also launch a program with a higher priority. Negative nice value will increase the priority A, the process. So the value has to be specified with A, that is two hyphens in front of the nice command as shown below. So to pass nice value of minus 5, you will add two hyphens in front of 5. To pass nice value of minus 6, you will add two hyphens in front of 6. As you see below, this program is now launched with a nice value of minus 10, which means this will run at a higher priority when compared to other programs that are launched by default. Regular users are not allowed to launch a program with a higher priority. Only root user is allowed to launch a program with high priority. As a regular user, if you increase the priority, you will get the following error message from nice command. After printing the above error message, the program would still continue to run with the default priority, that is 0. Altering scheduling priority. In this video, we are going to see about altering scheduling priority. Change the priority with option N. The process priority can be adjusted with the help of N option. Increase the priority. Decrease the priority. Change the priority of a running process. The priority of an already running process can be changed using renice command. In this example, the program test.pl is already running with a nice value of -10. We can change the nice value of the above program to -19 as shown below. Pass the process ID of the above program to -p option. Verify that the nice value got changed to -19. Change the priority of all processes that belongs to a group. Using G option, you can modify the priority of all processes that belongs to a group. The following command will change the nice value of all the process that belongs to Geek stuff to 5. Change the priority of all processes owned by user. Renice allows to alter the priority of all the processes owned by a specific user as shown below. The above command will change the priority of all the processes owned by user Bala. It will assign a nice value of 5 to all the processes that belongs to user Bala. Interactive process management tools. In this video, we are going to see about interactive process management tools. Command line tools. Top. This is a small tool which is pre-installed on many Unix systems. When you want an overview of all the processes or threads running in the system, Top is a good tool. Order processes on different criteria, the default of which is CPU. HTOP. HTOP is essentially an enhanced version of TOP. It's easier to sort by processes. It's visually easier to understand and has built-in commands for common things you would like to do. Plus, it's fully interactive. ATOP. ATOP monitors all processes much like TOP and HTOP. Unlike TOP and HTOP, however, it has daily logging of the processes for long-term analysis. It also shows resource consumption by all processes. It will also highlight resources that have reached a critical load. Apache TOP. Apache TOP monitors the overall performance of your Apache web server. It's largely based on MyTOP. It displays current number of reads, writes, and the overall number of requests processed. FTP TOP. FTP TOP gives you basic information of all the current FTP connections to your server, such as the total amount of sessions, how many are uploading and downloading, and who the client is. Desktop monitoring. NTOPNG. NTOPNG is the next generation of NTOP, and the tool provides a graphical user interface via the browser for network monitoring. It can do stuff such as geolocate host, get network traffic and show IP traffic distribution and analyze it. IFTOP. IFTOP is similar to TOP, but instead of mainly checking for CPU usage, it listens to network traffic on selected network interfaces and displays a table of current usage. It can be handy by answering questions such as, why on earth is my internet connection so slow? JNetTOP. JNetTOP visualizes network traffic in much the same way as IFTOP does. It also supports customizable text output and a machine-friendly mode to support further analysis. Infrastructure monitoring. Server density. Our server monitoring tool, it has a web interface that allows you to set alerts and view graphs for all system and network metrics. You can also set up monitoring of websites, whether they are up or down. Server density allows you to set permissions for users, and you can extend your monitoring with our plugin infrastructure or API. The service already supports Nagios plugins. GNOM System Monitor. GNOM System Monitor is a basic system monitoring tool that has features looking at process dependencies from a tree view, kill or re-nice processes, and graphs of all server metrics. Log monitoring tools. GoAxis. GoAxis is a real-time web log analyzer which analyzes the access log from either Apache, Nginx, or Amazon CloudFront. It will give you general statistics, top visitors, 404s, geolocation, and many other things. LogWatch. LogWatch is a log analysis system. It parses through your system's logs and creates a report analyzing the areas that you specify. It can give you daily reports with short digest of the activities taking place on your machine. Network monitoring. ACCT or PSACCT. ACCT or PSACCT, that is depending on if you use APT, GET or YUM, allows you to monitor all the commands a user executes inside the system, including CPU and memory time. Once installed, you get that summary with the command SA. WhoWatch. Similar to ACCT, this tool monitors users on your system and allows you to see in real time what commands and processes they are using. It gives you a tree structure of all the processes, and so you can see exactly what's happening. Job control. In this video, we are going to see about job control. In Linux or Unix, a job is defined as a task or command that has started running but not yet finished what it is doing. As Linux and Unix are multitasking operating systems, they allow you to run multiple commands simultaneously. Each running command is called a job and is assigned a unique ID called the job number. It is very easy to manage jobs in Linux. The main commands you use for job control in Linux are as follows. Jobs, list all the jobs that are running or suspended. FG, bring the job to the foreground. BG, send the job to the background. Stop or Control plus Z, suspend the job. Kill or Control plus C, terminate the job. The basics of job control. Every command you give is a job that is executed. A job can be suspended, placed in the background, moved back to the foreground, or terminated. Most commands like ls are executed fast, but things like moving huge files occupy your terminal for quite a while. In these cases, the job can be placed in the background, allowing you to execute other commands in the meantime. While running a command that is job, you can pause or suspend it with Ctrl Z and kill it with Ctrl C. When a job is suspended, it can be moved back to the foreground with FG and placed in the background, that is, where it will continue to execute with BG. How to run, suspend, and continue a command in the background. Example of how to run a job in the background. Putting a job in the background with and when executing. Killing a running job. Jobs applies to the running jobs in your current shell. Use top or PS aux to list all the running jobs on your computer. Scheduling process. In this video, we are going to see about the scheduling process. A Linux system can have a lot to suffer from, but it usually suffers only during office hours. Whether in an office environment, a server room, or at home, most Linux systems are just idling away during the morning, the evening, the nights, and weekends. Using this idle time can be a lot cheaper than buying those machines you'd absolutely need if you want everything done at the same time. There are three types of delayed execution. Waiting a little while and then resuming job execution. Using the sleep command, execution time depends on the system time at the moment of submission. Running a command at a specified time, using the at command, execution of the job, that is S, depends on system time, not the time of submission. Regularly running a command on a monthly, weekly, daily, or hourly basis using the cron facilities. The sleep command. The info page on sleep is probably one of the shortest there is. All sleep does is wait. By default, the time to wait is expressed in seconds. When you can't use the at command for some reason, it's 5 o'clock. You want to go home, but there's still work to do, and right now, somebody is eating system resources. Make sure there's an auto logout on your system and that you log out or log your desktop or office when submitting this kind of job or run it in a screen session. If you run a series of printouts of large files, but you want other users to be able to print in between. Programmers often use the sleep command to halt script or program execution for a certain time. The at command. The at command executes commands at a given time, using a default shell unless you tell the command otherwise. Typing Ctrl plus D quits the AT utility and generates the EOT message. User Steven does a strange thing here, combining two commands. The M option sends mail to the user when the job is done or explains when a job can't be done. The command ATQ lists jobs. Perform this command before submitting jobs in order to prevent them from starting at the same time as others. With the ATRM command, you can remove scheduled jobs if you change your mind. It is a good idea to pick strange execution times because system jobs are often run at round hours. For example, Jobs are often run at exactly 1 o'clock in the morning. Example, system indexing to update a standard locate database. So entering a time of 0100 may easily slow your system down rather than fire it up. To prevent jobs from running all at the same time, you may also use the batch command, which queues processes and feeds the work in the queue to the system in an evenly balanced way, preventing excessive burst of system resource usage. Conntab file format. In this video, we are going to see about Conntab file format. Conntab file format. Linux cron utility is an effective way to schedule a routine background job at a specific time or day on an ongoing basis. Linux Conntab format. Scheduling a job for a specific time. The basic usage of cron is to execute a job in a specific time as shown below. This will execute the full backup shell script, that is full backup, on 10th June 8:30 a.m. Please note that the time field uses 24 hours format. So for 8 a.m. use 8 and for 8 p.m. use 20. 30 to 30th minute, 8 to 8 a.m., 10 to 10th day, 6 to 6th month, that is June, every day of the week. Schedule a job for more than one instance, example twice a day. The following script takes incremental backup twice a day every day. This example executes a specific incremental backup shell script, that is incremental backup, at 11 and 16 on every day. The comma separated value in a field specifies that the command needs to be executed in all the mentioned time. 00, 0th minute, that is top of the hour, 11, 16 to 11 a.m. and 4 p.m. every day, every month, every day of the week. Schedule a job for a specific range of time, example only on weekdays. Cron job every day during working hours. This example checks the status of the database every day, that is including weekends, during the working hours 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. 00, 0th minute, that is top of the hour, 09 to 18 to 9 a.m., 10 a.m., 11 a.m., 12 a.m., 1 p.m., 2 p.m., 3 p.m., 4 p.m., 5 p.m., 6 p.m., every day, every month, every day of the week. Cron job every weekday during working hours. This example checks the status of the database every weekday, that is excluding Saturday and Sunday, during the working hours 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. How to view Conntab entries. View current logged in users Conntab entries. To view your Conntab entries, type Conntab I from your Unix account as shown below. View root Conntab entries. Log in as root user, that is su root, and do Conntab I as shown below. Conntab how to view other Linux users Conntab's entries. To view Conntab entries of the other Linux users, log in to root and cu, that is username, I as shown. How to edit Conntab entries. Edit current logged in users Conntab entries. To edit Conntab entries, use Conntab E as shown below. By default, This will edit the current logged in user's cron tab. When you see the About Temporary file with WQ, it will save the cron tab and display the following message indicating the cron tab is successfully modified. Edit root cron tab entries. Log in as root user, that is SU root, and do cron tab E as shown. Edit other Linux users cron tab file entries. To edit cron tab entries of other Linux users, log in to root and use U, that is username, E as shown. Schedule a job for every minute using cron. Ideally, you may not have a requirement to schedule a job every minute. The asterisk means all the possible unit, that is every minute of every hour throughout the year. More than using the asterisk directly, you will find it very useful in the following cases. When you specify *5 in minute field means every 5 minutes. When you specify 0 to 10 by 2 in minute field mean every 2 minutes in the first 10 minutes. Thus the above convention can be used for all the other 4 fields. Scheduled a background cron job for every 10 minutes. Use the following if you want to check the disk space every 10 minutes. It executes the specified command check disk space every 10 minutes throughout the year. But you may have a requirement of executing the command only during office hours or vice versa. There are special cases in which instead of the above 5 fields, you can use at the rate of followed by a keyword, that is such as reboot, midnight, yearly, hourly. Schedule a job for first minute of every year using at the rate of yearly. If you want a job to be executed on the first minute of every year, then you can use the at the rate of yearly cron keyword as shown. This will execute the system annual maintenance using annual maintenance shell script at 0000 on Jan 1st for every year. Schedule a cron job beginning of every month using at the rate of monthly. It is as similar as the asterisk yearly as above, but executes the command monthly once using at the rate of monthly cron keyword. This will execute the shell script take backup at 0000 on 1st of every month. Schedule a background job every day using at the rate of daily. Using the at the rate daily cron keyword, this will do a daily log file cleanup using cleanup logs shell script at 0000 on every day.